Today we're talking about U.S. monuments, both landmarks or monuments, as you wish, both man-made and natural. That'll be our only agenda for today. We'll have a Kahoot quiz as always. I'm going to go through these, and I'll first show a picture of this landmark. And if you know what it is, raise your hand. Don't shout it out. Raise your hand, like civilized group we are. And I will call on you, and if you get it right, we'll have some, I don't know what this is. Creme yogurt coming your way. Okay. Savakusam yagam vot. Man-made landmarks. Who knows what this is? You were the first one. Sorry? That's right. Catch it. There we go. Training for next week, because next week's baseball. All right? Mount Rushmore. That's correct. Now, does anyone know who these faces are? Yeah?
Boom.
Jefferson, Lincoln,
Washington,
well done, all four. This is going to be a tough one, but I'm going to get it.
There were no heads to hit there. So, that's right. Different order, but you got them all. You can't really see the white up there. It's on the chair right there. Well, my fault, you're lazy. Okay, Washington, Jefferson, Roosevelt, Lincoln. That's right. You know, it was actually originally supposed to go all the way down to the waist, like all the way down to here, but they ran out of money. So that ended as it was. You can kind of see how in Washington it was building to be kind of his whole body, you know? But it stopped just with their faces, with their heads. And Mount Rushmore is located in South Dakota, kind of the middle of nowhere. I was there once when I was a child. And South Dakota, North Dakota, not much going on there except for Mount Rushmore and Crazy Horse, which we'll see next. But it was constructed between 1927 and 1941. You can imagine that in 1941, resources and money was going towards the war or getting ready for it instead of things like this. And the idea started actually by a local South Dakotian. Name was Doane Robinson. He was a state historian, and he actually wanted to carve people from the American West. These were people like Lewis and Clark, Buffalo Bill, and Red Cloud. Red Cloud was a Indian chief. Buffalo Bill, do you know who Buffalo Bill was? No? Buffalo Bill did the Wild Wild West shows, and he'd basically kind of like a traveling circus, the first traveling circus in the Western United States. And Lewis and Clark, do you know who Lewis and Clark were? Huh? Lewis and Clark was the first commission expedition from Washington, D.C. to go across the entire United States to the Pacific Ocean, all the way west of the Missouri River. And they went across these Indian lands. They documented what was there. They mapped it, the whole region. They were looking for the source of the Missouri River. And they actually made it all the way to Oregon, all the way to the Pacific. They were almost killed several times. And Meriwether Lewis actually, when he returned, he got crazy, committed suicide after a couple of years of returning back to the East. William Clark lived a normal life. And these are two famous people in American history. And William Clark is actually my great-great-great-great uncle, believe it or not. Maybe that's why I travel too, I don't know. And they were originally known, so these mountains here were originally known as the Six Grandfathers. It was the name given by the local Indian tribe, the Lakota Sioux. But Washington, D.C. was given money for this, Congress was, they didn't really like the idea of these the Western figures. They thought that presidents would bring more tourists there and more attraction to the region, so they went with the president's heads. And Mount Rushmore. Why Mount Rushmore? I did not know this before making this slide. And it's actually named after a New York lawyer. A lawyer from New York who was doing an expedition here in 1885, liked the mountains, but way before the heads were even made. And the mountain was called Mount Rushmore.
a New York lawyer, city guy coming out to the Midwest. I was shocked to see that that's what this whole mountain was named after, just a New York lawyer. Like I said, I went here many years ago. There's also a place called Crazy Horse, also in South Dakota, and it's still being built. This is what it looks like today. This is what they're carving out of that. This is an Indian. His name's Crazy Horse, was a real man on his horse. And this is an ongoing project still going on today. And I like this one better because I feel it's more true to the roots of South Dakota and those lands and the Indians that for thousands of years lived there. And yeah, I think that's a beautiful, when it's done, it'll be very beautiful. And I hope to see it finished in my lifetime. We'll see. So that was Mount Rushmore. What's this? Right, hands, yes. That's right. Kingsley, the back row is paying attention today. You ready, man? Here we go. Woo, right at you. Bingo. Yeah. Baseball next week. Get ready. Statue of Liberty, that's right. Where does Statue of Liberty come from? Did the Americans make it?
France.
France, that's right. Might run out of these. Well, you already got one. Okay. It was from France, that's right. It's in New York City, of course, right there. This part is from France. And the pedestal was made in America. They shipped this actually in parts. It was constructed in the late 1800s in France. They actually had the torch and the head and the crown on display in France before shipping it over here, over there. We're not in the US right now. And on the tablet, it has July 4th, 1776. Why that? The date of American independence. That's when the Declaration of Independence was signed. John Hancock on there. And this was a site of many immigrants coming to the United States. Have you heard of Ellis Island before? Ellis Island is an island right outside of New York City. And it was used as the receiving spot for all of the immigrants coming into the United States. That's where the customs and that's where the control and documentation of immigrants into the U.S. between 1892 and 1954. So for 61 years, just about. More than 60 years, that was used as the processing place for immigrants coming in. Some immigrants would just get to the island and then be rejected and sent back. But for most people, this was the first sight of America that they saw. And so it's one of the most iconic symbols of the United States. You can actually go up into the crown. You could until last year. Now it's no longer allowed. And until World War I, you could also go up into the torch. And there was a factory that was bombed and was blown up and actually broke part of the torch in the hand. The torch is not original. They had to make a new one. But that was also interesting for me to learn about that. So Statue of Liberty in New York City. We look at the height of statues, of sculptures in the world. And the Spring Temple Buddha in China is massive, huge. Then we see his other one. Statue of Liberty comes in second. Where's this?
Stalingrad.
Yes, Stalingrad. And Christ the Redeemer. Brazil and Rio de Janeiro. And David. That's not me, David. That's the statue of David, you know. Where's this? Yeah. That's right. You already got one and you didn't accept my delivery, so. San Francisco, Golden Gate Bridge. That's actually a very unique view of that, because almost always this is covered with fog. And is this picture taken in the morning or the evening? Anyone know? Here's the city and here is the Pacific Ocean. What time is this picture taken? Evening, that's correct. Because here's the Pacific Ocean, the sun sets in the west and it's shining against the bridge here. So this is, and in the evening it usually has a much clearer view. There's usually a much clearer view of the bridge. But in the morning it's always, almost always covered in fog. So many times I've stood right here
and I cannot even see the bridge. Or I can just see the top of this. The rest of this, nothing. So many times, maybe 50% of the time. So that's a very unique picture. Of course, that's in San Francisco, California, and the West Coast, the best coast. And this is more what it typically looks like. You know, you got fog covering over the top, you can't see the whole thing. Constructed from 1933 to 1937, it was the largest suspension bridge in the world until 1964. It's 1.3 kilometers long. It is known as one of the, by engineers, known as one of the modern world wonders. And over 100,000 cars cross that bridge every day. 100,000. And each one of them, when entering the city, so southbound, it's maybe 50% of them, they have to pay about 10 rubles to cross the bridge. Southbound cars. So you can imagine, that's a lot. Let's say 50,000 are going in each day. Each one pays, you know, 10 rubles. That's like 500,000 rubles spent each day by people crossing that bridge. So, moneymaker. Well, it costs them a lot to make it and to upkeep it. So yeah, that's the San Francisco Golden Gate Bridge. Kind of a, for the West Coast, it's an iconic symbol of San Francisco and of the United States. This is a more difficult one. I want hands, if you know, if you have a guess. It's near Las Vegas. 30 miles from Las Vegas. It's a dam named after a president. Hoover Dam. This is the Hoover Dam. Has anyone heard of that? Nope. Ooh, okay. So, next to Las Vegas, right here. The quality of the screen not that good, but down here in Las Vegas, it's actually in Nevada. The dam itself was built also in the 30s, 31 to 36. It holds back the largest amount of water of any dam in the US. It's not the tallest or the biggest dam. That's actually up in my region, closer to the Oroville, the one that was almost breaking, that almost flooded the whole area in my hometown. My mom works and everything. But this dam holds back the largest amount of water than any other dam in the United States. And this bridge, the bypass bridge, was built in, just in 2010, before you had to always drive actually over the dam to get across it. And it's 221 meters tall, 376 meters wide, and it actually is used to create a lot of energy. Here's a release of water that's coming across. But in the West, we use a lot of hydro energy, a lot of energy from dams, from the pressure of water is used to turn turbines and create energy. We use a lot of that where I am from. So Hoover Dam in Nevada, named after President Hoover. What's this? Raise your hand. I know you know this one. Someone does. Yeah? Huh? Maybe? Yeah, you're talking about it. Which one? Take a guess. It's on the West Coast. Sorry? Raise your hand so I know who's speaking. What? Las Vegas? No, it's in Seattle. Yeah?
Manhattan.
Not quite.
Chicago.
No, it's in Seattle. Huh?
Seattle,
yes, but what is this called? It's called the Seattle Space Needle. What? Space Needle in Seattle. Seattle's in Washington, Washington State. I know in Russian, people, you often say Washington for Washington, D.C., but in the United States, and especially in the West Coast, if we say Washington, we're talking about the state of Washington. And if we're talking about Washington, D.C., we will say D.C. or Washington, D.C. So, просто Washington, у нас это, yeah, state Washington. So, the state of Washington, the capital of Washington is Seattle. This is the Space Needle. It was built in the 60s, actually built in only like 9 months. And it was built for the 1962 World Fair. This up top is a restaurant. And you can sit and have your lunch, and the restaurant actually rotates. It'll turn all the way around, and you'll see the whole city of Seattle. Not fast, you won't get motion sickness. But it's built to withstand all kinds of natural disasters, including earthquakes up to 9.1,
and magnitude, and 200 mile per hour winds, or 89 meters per second. That's really fast. So there's also a 25 lightning rods, and they are used to catch electricity so that lightning strikes will not destroy the tower itself. And you've seen this video. This is one storm in which the Space Needle here, the closed circuit camera is not that good quality, but you see how it gets struck, it's struck very often, but is entirely safe. So, that was easy. The One World Trade Center. This was actually built on the point of where the former World Trade Center 1, World Trade Center 2 buildings were constructed. It's actually directly built on top of World Trade Center 6. World Trade Center building number 6 was not hit by the planes, but when number 1 and number 2 fell down, they also destroyed some of the other buildings in the area. One of them was World Trade Center number 6, and that is the point where this has been reconstructed. And there's a really beautiful video I'll show you about this. This is, of course, in New York City. And it was constructed from 2006 until 2013. Like I said, stands where World Trade Center 6 used to be. It is the tallest building in the Western Hemisphere. So anywhere in the Americas, north or south, is the tallest building. And it stands at 1,776 feet. Why is this number important? Look at that. You're the first person to catch it. You were nervous about that. Independence Day, that's right. It's also written on the tablet on the Statue of Liberty. At the time it was built, nearly $4 billion. It was the most expensive building in the world. Look at comparison to other buildings in the United States. We see that it is the tallest now, and the Empire State Building used to be the tallest in New York, no longer is. Trump Tower's not the biggest in the room, but So, what is this? It's in Chicago. It's the last one of our man-made landmarks. All right, it's actually called the Cloud Gate, but I know it as the Bean, the Chicago Bean, and it's like I said, it's in Chicago, in Illinois, and it was recently constructed, just finished about over 10 years ago. It's inspired by liquid mercury. Have you seen liquid mercury on a video before, how it kind of moves and reflects? That's what this is supposed to be like.
And it's actually 168 stainless steel panels welded together and then very, very, very well polished, so you do not see any of the seams. This is actually the ground that you see, those lines. It's not the seams, it's actually the ground. It's just like one mercury bean. Mercury bean. Whoa. And I've never seen this before. I'd really like to see this. You see a reflection, you see these people walking by, boom. It's a huge mercury beam known as Cloud Gate or The Bean, and it's in Chicago. One of my favorites, mainly because I have not seen it. So, that wraps us up for man-made landmarks, now natural. These are the best, I think, because these take millions of years to be created, and not just a bunch of money. So what is this? Raise your hand. Yes, you have not answered yet. That's right. Easy toss. Boom. Grand Canyon. Does anyone know what state the Grand Canyon is located in? Yeah?
Nevada.
Sorry?
Nevada.
Not quite. Next to it?
Oh.
Yeah! Coming at you. Ooh-ah! Mala Diaz, nice catch. This is the Grand Canyon. This is called Horseshoe Bend. The Colorado River flows then through here. Ooh, that would have been a good question for the Kahoot quiz. What river flows through the Grand Canyon? Ah, the Colorado River flows through here, and the canyon itself is massive. It's created by the Colorado River of millions of years of carving through the canyon. This is what it looks like from space. You can kind of see it looks like the veins of a leaf or a living organism or a plant, because the river, it's just gone through here and seeped out in these different directions and carved this out over millions of years. So this is an aerial shot from Arizona. And you see right here, boom, Arizona. It's right next to Nevada and Utah, but the actual Grand Canyon itself, the heart of it and everything is in Arizona. It's nearly 2 kilometers deep in some points. And the whole canyon itself is more than 400 kilometers long, and it has a width of up to 29 kilometers in width in some points. This was a massive river, the Colorado River, flowing through here for more than 6 million years to create this canyon. It was inhabited by Native Americans for thousands of years and seen as a holy site. And it's very impressive. And if you ever go to America in your life, I highly recommend you see this, because you stand on the edge of this and you just feel like you are so small. You are so small. Because, I mean, this is just one little segment. I mean, the thing is huge, more than 400 kilometers. I mean, you feel like, wow, nature will always win. Yeah, nature will always win. So, that is the Grand Canyon. What is this? This valley? This national park?
Yellowstone.
Not quite. Almost. Very close. Another one? I know you know it. I know you've heard of it. We talked about it in the California segment. Sounds like Yellowstone. No? Oops, sorry. How do you say this? How do you read that? Как читать вот это? Это слово. Пожалуйста, говорите. So? Я не слушаю. Yosemite. We make jokes sometime, we call it Yosemite. It's actually Yosemite, but if you say Yosemite, people will know what you're talking about. It's actually Yosemite, but we will say Yosemite sometimes, just because it looks like Yosemite, yeah? So you can say both, but it's really called Yosemite. This is Half Dome. You see, it looks like a dome, and it's cut in half. Massive glacier came through here and just... We're going to hear about a guy who climbs that with no rope. Amazing. It is in California, Northern California. It's about 3 hours from Chico, my hometown. And it's called Yosemite, which is actually a word in Miwok, which is a language of the Miwok people, a Native American tribe that used to live here.
They were chased off, and they were known as being very violent, even to other Native American tribes. And they referred to them as the killers, the Miwok as killers. In their language, it was Yosemite. So today, the area is called Yosemite after this Native American word. Even though it's kind of a negative word, I like that it's named after the Native Americans. They lived here for thousands of years. This is also considered a very holy site, and different tribes would come to this region. Today, more than 5 million people a year visit Yosemite Valley, but most of them just stay in this. There's a road that you can drive down through this valley. Most of them just stay in that little valley segment, but the park itself is huge. Go camping there. When I was in school, we actually had our whole class. We went camping in Yosemite for a weekend with all of the students. It's it's a very famous natural site in California, in the United States. And 95% of the park is basically left untouched, and it's just for wilderness, like these deer you see here. This is a man who's very famous for what he does in Yosemite. This is one of the most astonishing athletes I've ever seen. They refer to him as the Michael Jordan of climbing. And he climbs this with no safety equipment, no gear, just with his shoes and his hands. Watch this.
So, in terms of free soloing, undoubtedly the greatest free soloist that ever lived is this kid, Alex Honnold. Pretty quiet, grew up in the suburbs of Sacramento, and he pretty much, you know, you think next generation, what are people going to do? Well, he's kind of skipped a generation and started soloing things that were unthinkable. I'm going to play a quick little video from about Alex.
Free soloing has to be the ultimate in free climbing.
So it's a beautiful day and you're out soloing.
To free solo is to go without a rope, to go without gear, to only have your rock shoes and your chalk bag and the power of the mind. It's also very profound. The reason it's probably the ultimate is one wrong move, you fall, you die.
Yeah, let me try that again.
And the person at the top of this game, and it's hard to even call this a game, is Alex Honnold. Alex Honnold is probably a perfect example. He is someone who's not only trained very hard, but is unbelievably gifted. He is like Michael Jordan.
Traveling from one destination to another.
Yeah, I would say that Yosemite probably is the center of my climbing, that all my climbing goals, all like training, all kind of revolves around things that I want to do in Yosemite.
This is by far my favorite place for soloing, because the walls are so inspiring, like everything here is so big, and that's like what gets me excited about soloing stuff.
1,000 meters tall.
I put my rope away and switched to soloing. I just had a moment of like, this is like surreally cool. I was like, I can't believe I'm up here with no rope, just climbing. Like, this is rad.
Now Alex has now done the regular route on Half Dome free solo. So for most people on this planet who are serious climbers, doing Half Dome in a day or two is considered fantastic. Alex did it in 3 hours. Without a rope.
You know, you commit, you're like, I'm doing this, here I go. But then after like a couple hours of being all committed, you're like, man, I'm tired. And like, you know, your mind starts to get a little bit tired. And so I kind of stalled out, and then I started to doubt if I was doing it right or if I had the right holds. Why am I even here? You know, do I want to do this?
Just come back.
That stalled him out, that paralyzed him. And then he overcame it. He didn't work that route 100 times. He just got up, below it, looked up at it, and believed, absolutely believed, that it was well within his ability.
It's amazing.
And it seems like in this last season, I've sort of
It looks like he's just going to a restaurant. You know, he's dressed to go to a restaurant. He goes out and climbs this huge mountain with no rope.
This is why I'm here. Like, this is awesome.
So Alex is actually from Sacramento, like they said, which is the big city in our region, about 100 kilometers from where I'm from. But truly amazing. Truly amazing man. I just watch that and I feel uncomfortable. You know, it's like, I feel... What is this? You said it. Raise your hand. Oh, coming at you. Bingo, Niagara Falls. Anyone know what this boat's called? The Maid of the Mist. It's been going for more than 100 years. It takes tourists on top and it goes into the falls and comes back. Does that for 100 years. Niagara Falls. The largest waterfall in North America. It borders Canada and New York State. And it's actually the largest in terms of flow, in terms of how much water is going over. It is the largest in the world. More than 20 million tourists a year visit this from both the Canadian and American side. And there's been issues with the erosion, like it's actually going away. Especially this part here is called the American Falls. There's actually three falls. The American Falls, the Horseshoe Falls. There's another one, a small one right here on the side. But the two basic big ones are the American Falls and the Horseshoe Falls. They can actually close this off to work with erosion. So they actually dam it up on that side, and they work with the erosion processes here. Kind of crazy to turn off the waterfall, you know? Just flock it off, and then it diverts all the way over there. But yeah, this is what it looks like with no water. And there's been a lot of people in the last century who have gone over the falls. This lady here, Annie Edson Taylor, was the first one to do it. She went in 1901 inside that barrel over the waterfalls and lived. This man has also did it in this concoction of a barrel. And some people have lived, some people have died. There was a situation where a boy and a young boy and a young girl fell into the water. These two kids, they were able to pull the girl out about 10 meters away from the edge, but the boy went over the falls and he lived with no barrel or anything, and he lived. But many people have also died going over the falls. What is the name of this geyser? Does anyone know the name of this geyser? What park is this famous geyser in? What national park is this geyser in the United States?
Yellowstone.
If I saw a hand, I would throw you a candy, but I don't see any hands. That's right, it's in Yellowstone. It's called Old Faithful. Why Old Faithful? Well, because Old Faithful, here in Yellowstone, in Wyoming, the state of Wyoming, it erupts every 45 minutes to 125 minutes. In fact, since 2000, it has never not erupted within this time interval. It always goes within 44 and 125. And that's why it's called Old Faithful. It's always going to go. It always goes. And it lasts for 3 to 10 minutes, and it can reach a height of up to 56 meters. You can see here, this is the Old Faithful geyser erupting in the winter. The temperature outside is about 0 degrees Celsius, and it's really magnificent, really beautiful. But this is only one site in Yellowstone National Park. Yellowstone also is the home of the oldest and the largest herd of bison. I know bison are important for Belarus, so it's important to mention this about Yellowstone. You can see the sulfuric activity. Like, this is all like sulfur coming up in little sulfur grounds from the volcanic activity underneath the earth. But beautiful Yellowstone National Park in Wyoming. The largest amount of bison are there. They actually used to be an endangered species.
bison were seen as just target practice in the West. People would just go out with the gun and just go, and then just leave them there. And there used to be too many, and then there was too few, and now they have a controlled population. A lot of them are in Wyoming, in Yellowstone National Park. And it was the first national park in the United States, made in 1872. Yellowstone, very beautiful. I get to go there this summer. I'm excited about that. I will be surprised if anyone gets this. Any ideas? It is an island. But it's also a big lake, and it's in a crater. Hence, Crater Lake. So, how do you think this could be made? Any ideas? Sorry?
Is it great over the volcano?
Yes, exactly. I used to think when I was younger that like a meteor hit this and made this, but it's actually in the crater volcano, and it's in Oregon, the state south of Washington, north of California. It's about 4 hours from Chico, and it's exactly like you said. It's made
thousands of years
from a volcano.
Mount Mazama, a 3,700-meter volcanic mountain, covered the Crater Lake site. Beneath the mountain was a large chamber of magma, a collection of gas and molten rock. In a tremendously powerful eruption more than 6,000 years ago, cracks opened beneath the volcano and drained away several cubic kilometers of molten material. The weight of the volcanic cone then collapsed into the emptied chamber, leaving behind a great basin, a caldera. The caldera later filled with water, and Crater Lake was created.
So it was a volcano. All of the lava underneath went away, it drained out, and there was this big hole under the volcano, and the volcano fell inside of itself and created Crater Lake, as we see today. And there's absolutely no light pollution there. You can see beautiful stars, and here's a time lapse of how beautiful this place really is.
World's rise, she lets you come in. To all begins, to the Hollywood den of lonely. Look down from the tower on high, and take in the night, look her right in the eye. She'll listen as you go for a ride.
It's a very beautiful natural site, and I've never been there, even though it's only about 4 hours from where I live. What are these mountains? Any ideas? Guesses? Take a guess, please. Yes? Take a guess. I know you're just scratching your head, but take a guess. What mountains do you know in the United States? But seriously. Huh? Who said this? Yes. I want to. Whoever catches it gets to keep it.
Oh!
Next week's baseball, you better start practicing, I'm serious. Rocky Mountains. They are the largest mountain range in the United States, actually in North America, but not the highest. Looking at this, you may be surprised. From the three mountain ranges in America, there are the Sierra Nevadas in California, the Rocky Mountains, which actually start all the way up in Alaska, and the Appalachian Mountains in the east. The highest point is actually in the Sierra Nevadas in California, Mount Whitney, 4,440 something meters. In the Rocky Mountains, it's very close, 4,400, and it's just 40 meters lower. But you see, the Rocky Mountains, they actually extend all the way up into Alaska. Does anyone know how the Rocky Mountains were made? Yeah? How are they made? Well, there's two huge tectonic plates. Tectonic plates. You know tectonic plates?
Yes? Tectonic plates. Okay? There's the Pacific plate, there's the North American plate, and they butted against each other about, 55, 80 million years ago. And there wasn't much space. They butted against each other, and one goes underneath the other one and pushes the other one up. It's called subduction. And so they're forcing against each other. There was not much space to go down, so then one of the plates went up and started pushing all of this up. So this was the edge of the plate, and it just pushed the Earth up. So the two tectonic plates, bam, 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 and that created the Rocky Mountains. The highest point, 4,400 meters, Mount Elbert, and the length is nearly 5,000 kilometers.
Huge.
Huge, huge, huge. This is the High Tetons in Wyoming. Beautiful mountain range. What is this? It's in California.
Death Valley.
Yes! Death Valley. There we go. Death Valley is right. Any ideas? Why Death Valley? Well, what?
Nothing living there.
That really, there's not much. It's in Southern California. You see, a lot of these nature sites are in California. That's why nature is maybe so important to me. So, Death Valley, not much living there because it's actually one of the hottest places on Earth. The hottest recorded temperature ever on Earth in 1913 of 56.7 degrees Celsius was recorded in Death Valley. And in 2001, for 154 days in a row, the temperature was over 100 degrees Fahrenheit, or 38 degrees Celsius. That's hot for more than half the year, every day, over 38. Very, very hot. Death Valley. So that's the last of our natural sites. We're going to have a Kahoot quiz. Next week we have baseball, and I have a guest coming from Germany. We've played together in the Bundesliga in Germany, and a baseball team in the baseball Bundesliga in Germany together. This is actually me about 10 years ago in California. And we will play some baseball. We'll learn about baseball. If we have good weather, we may even bring it outside and try to play. Okay? Because it'll be very difficult to react, to recreate baseball in the classroom. So we'll give that a try next week. And I think that'll be really fun. I'm gonna have him bring some stuff from Germany, some baseball stuff, along with what I've got here. But now we have the Kahoot quiz. I think this one's kind of an easy one.
Range in North America.
The Rocky Mountains. Sierra Nevada has the highest point, but as for a range, for a mountain range, it's not the largest. The range includes everything, range. Next question. Kleinstadt boy, wer ist denn das? Who is that? Hey. Die nächste Frage. In what city is the Golden Gate Bridge? San Francisco, of course. Los Angeles is Hollywood and all that other crap. San Francisco is the Golden Gate Bridge. Kleinstadt boy still in the lead. Next question. Helen right behind, only 3 points.
Doing two.
What is the tallest building in America? One World Trade Center. Space Needle's not that tall. Statue of Liberty is not that tall. One World Trade Center. Well done. Still in the lead. Next question. Free soloist Alex Holland is famous for climbing formations in this park. Yosemite, Yosemite, Yellowstone nominees, not exactly, that's in Wyoming, Death Valley, not many high points there, Grand Canyon, I'm sure he's climbed it, but he's not famous for it. Next question, Crater Lake was formed by what? Volcano collapse, like the video showed. I think it's kind of a cool idea, the meteor, but it's not quite. Kleinstadtboy still in the lead, but it's very close. Whoa, they came out of nowhere. All right, underdog. Helen fell off. Oh, ouch. Next question. What is the name of Yellowstone's most famous geyser? Old Faithful! Almost everyone got that right. Great. Half Dome is the rock formation that Alex climbed in Yosemite. Kleinstadtboy still in the lead. Very, very, very close. Who's... Okay. Next question. In which American city is the Cloud Gate, also known as the Bean? Which city? A little bit more difficult. Chicago! Not LA, not New York, not Seattle. Seattle's the space needle. Whoa, very, very close. Next question. This is a picture of what? Grand Canyon from space, that's right. Death Valley is close. Yellowstone, nope, too dry. Ooh, she took the lead. All right, guys, next question. Niagara Falls is located between Canada and which American state? New York, California is like 4,000 kilometers away, maybe five. Colorado's another 2,005 kilometers away. Michigan is close, it's got the Great Lakes, but it is New York. New York and Canada. Whew, still very close. Final question. It's kind of difficult. Which one of these presidents is not featured on Mount Rushmore? Hoover! It's the Hoover Dam. All right, most did that well. The result is... Oh! Kleinstadtboy fell off the... Who is a kapow? Ah, kapoo! All right. And who was first place? Oh, and kapoo. Kapoo! Oh! Train those hands for next week, bro. Baseball's coming to town. All right, Kleinstadtboy fell off at the last second. Ouch. Jack came out of nowhere, though. Little Trump, be close, but not this time. All right. Thank you, guys. I hope you enjoyed that and learned about a few new places. We'll see you next week with our... Sanimeskim drugom. Arashol. Do svidaniya.